right. Welcome, everyone, on our live stream. We are just getting everything rolling here, and we'll get started in just a moment. All right. Welcome, everyone, to Westlake Pro. Everyone, give it up for Michael Boddicker, for Aspen Pittman, for Dead Rock West. Thank you all for joining us. We have a very exciting evening planned for everyone here tonight. We are going to be getting the first listen to the Space Station XL, an incredible box and incredible predecessor to the beloved Space Station V3. So it's very exciting to get to hear that. We've got some great giveaways. My name is Dean. I'm the director of marketing here at Westlake Pro, and we are a full-service pro audio retailer as well as studio design group. So anything you need in terms of, you know, whether you're just looking to get an interface or a microphone or maybe a DT1 or a space station, all the way up to a full studio design and integration project, we can help you out with that. We've got some great giveaways here tonight. We're going to be giving away 5 DT1 plus the magnetic pop filters. The odds are pretty good. That's right. Giving out 5 of those combo packs there. And we are going to be giving away signed copies of the Tube Amp Book by yours truly.
You have six copies.
Great. Awesome. So we also have some great promos. If you're looking to, you know, we'll talk a little bit more about this later, but if you're looking to get into a space station, we've got some great promos here tonight. If you get a space station, you can get 10% off, or if you would like to pick up a free DT1 mic with any Space Station V3 purchase, $139 value, and a great mic, as you can hear right here, hooked up into the space station, actually. So a great combination for you. We're going to be talking about some great products here, but I don't want to take up too much time talking, so I'd like to bring Aspen up to the stage.
All right. Thank you, Dean. Thank you very much. And really, I'm so excited about this because this is the first time we've actually had the XL that we're going to be showing to you. What I'm speaking to you through right now is called CenterPoint Stereo. It is a patented technology. We licensed that to Fender. We've been building several versions of this for over 15 years. We've kind of slowly become an overnight sensation. And because we do have kind of a sensational idea to produce stereo from a single box, which was the brainstorm of my dear departed friend Drew Daniels, and I developed this. This is a plexiglass version, just to give you an idea how it looks, and there's a lot of stuff online that tells you how this works, but essentially, if you have a recording background, it's a reverse MS microphone. Instead of inhaling a front and side microphone, putting it through a sum and difference matrix and producing left and right, Drew's brilliant idea, which we developed, was to inhale a stereo signal, go through the same matrix backwards, and produce left and right. And the way that basically works is, if you know much about stereo, there's a lot of stuff in the left and right channel that is the same. It's what we put in the center, like maybe the vocal. Then we have stuff over here on the right and over here on the left that's unique to left and right. So what basically the front speaker reproduces after coming through that encoding matrix, it produces everything that's the same, or the sum of left and right. If you were to take a stereo signal to a typical PA, they're going to run it mono so that everybody can hear the same thing no matter where they stand. It's mono. So the side speaker, however, is the difference. What isn't the same in left and right, that comes through another amplifier and another speaker. And you notice it's mounted basically physically out of phase, which is how the trick works. Those two speakers won't mix. Problem with traditional left-right stereo, they will mix, and unless you're right where they come together with the same energy, which I call the sweet spot, you don't hear stereo. You hear too much left, too much right, like the lit conversations today. but at any rate, when you're with centerpoint stereo, because they don't mix, this produces a different signal than that, 100%. They don't cancel because there's nothing the same that's in those signals. Normally, if you put two speakers together out of phase physically, they will cancel. They don't cancel because there's nothing there that's the same. So the sum and the difference creates this amazing effect of two speakers pushing each other away like two magnets. In a sense, that's how it works. If you want to hear more about it, go online. What we found when we did it is it worked amazingly well. We had no idea how well it would work. We knew we had something, and then we started developing it. This is the third version, the V3 third version. I think it's the most elegant one we ever did. It has a lot of DSP programming to make this speaker sound as good as it does in a small box. There's a lot of other tricks we're doing. It has four amplifiers, four components. It has a tweeter, it has a woofer, it has a mid-horn, and a side speaker. You notice a hole in the side speaker, so it has high frequency out the side. So it's a full-range speaker that goes equally in both directions, full frequency response. And then the four knobs in the back are literally the four amplifiers on those devices. So it's a tri-amp front end, and then it's got its own amp on the side speaker. So controlling those four allow you to further modify the sound for the room you're in. If it's a dead room like this, I might use a little more width. If it's a very live room, and by the way, the worse the room is, the more reflections, the better this works, because these two speakers push each other away. Every time they see each other, they push each other away. You take two speakers with a 45-degree dispersion, they wind up with a 300-degree dispersion between the two because they're always working against each other. They work best on the floor, not on a stand, for instance, over there. And we're going to show you a little bit of that when Michael plays. I'll turn it on and off very quickly. But the thing we found in practice was that this thing created two new solutions to issues that had been a common problem from day one. Musicians playing together can't hear each other, and people going to listen to live music can't talk to each other. So we discovered, having put this out in clubs and people using it, that the first thing was, if we could get the whole band mixed through a mixer, which you're going to hear, a couple of vocals and beautiful vocals and some keyboards and guitars all coming through one speaker, everybody hears the same mix. They can hit their harmonies, they can hit their levels, because they all have the same mix. It's the PA, it's the monitor, it's the keyboard amp, it's the guitar amp, all through a mixer coming out of one speaker in the room. And it's the same mix that everybody in the room, no matter where you sit, you're going to hear the same sound. So that was the second problem. How do we produce sound that we know everybody is going to enjoy and hear in stereo? So that's the two big problems playing out live. And you might find something else. If you have someone with you that you're talking to, try talking to him during the time that he's playing or the music's playing. You're going to find that you don't have to scream. Your voice will not be interfered with. It's a very natural flat sound, but more importantly, we're only in phase with one of those speakers, so we're really only interfered with one speaker. With two, three, four, five speakers in a room, they create a mishmash of reflective waves that compete with our vocals and our ability to talk to each other, so it's a very pleasant environment to go listen to live music. Now, with that, I'm going to very quickly conclude. Again, thank you for coming. And I want to bring up a dear, dear friend of mine who's been a fan and a supporter of Centerpoint Stereo from the very beginning, Mr. Michael Boddicker, who really needs no introduction. He's the king of the keys, the sultan of synth. And the MLB is not for baseball, let me tell you. In our world, it's Michael Lehman Boddicker. Now, Michael's agreed to just give me one quick demo at the beginning before he starts his program, and he's going to tell you about that. A lot of people want to know what it sounds like normally. If you play through a keyboard amp and you have a Leslie, Leslie's perhaps the hardest thing to demonstrate. Because I told you we do have a volume control on the side speaker, I'm going to turn the side speaker, or the difference sound, the thing that makes stereo, I'm going to turn that off right now. I'm going to swing this around real quick. And a little more level. We got level. Now I'm going to turn it. Sorry, that was me. The width control is off, and now I'm going to turn it on. Off. On. That's good. With that, I'm going to stop talking and let... Now, I have a lot of videos online. You want to hear me talk, which you probably don't. Tonight was an idea to bring you in and let you actually hear the music. The videos, ultimately, are listened to online by traditional stereo. And this is not. This is, you're going to hear Centerpoint Stereo. There's another thing we're going to do during the evening is a lot of people ask me, what do two sound like? If one sounds that good. So I recommend either two right on top of each other or one in the very rear, which we have. And we'll be turning up a rear one during the evening. Is that up? You going to turn that up for me now? So just give him a little extra. All right, so there we go. Now, we've been listening to the V3, so what I'm going to do now is turn the V3 off, and Brian is actually going to do it. Brian Asenzo, our engineer. And now you're going to hear the XL. This does not require low-frequency boost, as the S3 might if you want low-end. And Michael, take it away.
Very full. Do I have a microphone? There you go. So I can talk. So, no, I'm good. I'm very good. I'm just going to be out of my way. Thank you, Aspen. Aspen's, wow, that's my internal noise.
Ammons always make noise. That's
oh, yeah. Yeah, good. That is. I have been a fan since the first time I heard it. And I started with previous versions, and this new, the XL, completely blows me away. It's a synth player, but we're always asked to do much more. You know, a guitar player generally one kind of frequency range, all that. They don't have to play bell patches or string patches or bass parts or piano clav Wurlitzer and B3 as well as brass. And to have a synth amplifier that I can move was especially one that gave me an aural, A-U-R, effect in the room was really a joy. So let's see if I can. I'm just going to demonstrate some sounds to let you know the power of. Let me get situated here. Sorry. Somebody came in and helped me out. Split this keyboard, and so you can hear. Grabbing the steering wheel is never a good idea. Clarity. the beauty, I mean, I got low end, I got, you could hear kind of the pingy bell. So I've just run through a bunch of patches here for you. I think I have a bell here. I mean, or power synth. Electronics are usually 30 feet above and about 15 feet out in front of the orchestra. So there's no balancing. Nobody gets to play with you. They're just playing and you're supposed to play your part, and we in the audience, we hear that discrepancy. This way, you can have an axe on stage that allows you, as a synth player, I'm not talking about the wide range. You're putting a band through it later. But for me to be able to play all of my parts.
Yeah, you're inside the orchestra with them.
I am indeed. Sounds right. So we've got things that I would play live. Thank you.
That bass, acoustic bass, can you play a real low C? That patch that you have with the Vive?
I can, let me see.
I did not plant that. But,
time. Can you do the switch? Oh, you already did? This is the fifth three.
Internal box right here. You also have, by the way, guys, balanced output. So this is two channels now. You can put two channels in. It's balanced in, balanced out. And the sub is actually mono and sub. These are either TRS or XLR, and they go to the main house or to another system or something. You have left, right, and then mono, the sum output. So you can do any number of things with the other one. And it's got two channels in with two sensitivities. So we can set the sensitivity for a mixer as we have now, or a keyboard, you know, -10 or +4, essentially. And then you have the ability with it's a bi-amp front end, a coaxial 12. This is a special speaker made for this box by Eminence. And then we have a titanium driver. So with a titanium driver, we don't need the high frequency tweeter like we have in the are we back on the XL now, Brian? Did you go back? Okay, let's let Dead Rock sing a little bit.
We'll do that. But I've been Michael kicked off. I'm an unpaid endorser.
When Michael was playing the piano sounds, was that with the subwoofer on or
No, there's no subwoofer. Oh, when you were using missing the space, the S3, yes. But with the XL, no.
You want to show the difference? Oh, so when he was using the XL, it wasn't on, right?
No. There's no XL with the. There's no sub needed with the XL.
Oh, okay.
No, that's a 12-inch. Yeah, we have an 8-inch. Over here, if you guys want to see these later, this is the side speaker out of the cabinet. This is the coaxial 8-inch speaker. It's a polycone with a foam surround. This is the new one they make. It's a 12-inch version of the little one. They don't make these for anybody else. They make them. It's our design. Eminence builds these in the United States. They ship them to their factory in China where they build the cabinets, and we assemble them over there. So they're about 50% American content, by the way. Not easy to find today. So that's kind of how they work. The big guy has 750 watts. There's 250 watts distributed to the two side speakers, the mid-horn and the woofer, so three amplifiers of 250, 750 watts. The little guy is 280 watts, 200 watt amps on the woofer, and the tweeter, and then the woofer and the side speaker, and then 240 watts amps on the tweeter, and then the mid horn here.
Did you just say it's 750 watts?
The new one.
On the big one.
Yeah.
And the
280.
280.
Two times 100 for the woofer and the side speaker here, and then two times 40 for the tweeter and the coaxial. Okay, now Denrock West. I don't really need a microphone, do I?
No.
I like that little wind, yes. So I can use the proximity. They're going to be singing through our DT1s, which we're auctioning off. We're giving away, pardon me. Auctioning for free. We call it DT1 because it's a dual top mic, because the top comes off and it's no longer a vocal mic. It's a guitar mic or an overhead drum mic. It's a true condenser. It's a hypercardioid pattern, so you get to be really right on it for it to be working. And so you have the ability to be into it and get the very white sound, or you can be well off it like this and get the loud sound. It's very linear. But anyway, so I'm going to introduce Denrock West. That's Frank, Becky, and Phil. And Cindy and Phil. Party Cindy. Yeah, I forgot the last part right. And anyway, they have a new CD out that you'll be hearing during the beginning of the end. Some of the songs will be on it. They're a beautiful vocal group, and I want you to hear what they're going to be doing is playing. You can turn my mic off. They're going to be playing through one speaker where everybody hears the same sound at the same time, knowing that's what you're hearing. And that's a dream come true for live performers. So you got it, guys. Have fun. Play some songs.
All right.
So the first thing I'm tripping out on this thing is there's the monitor issue is not an issue. Which is something that's always a drag for me. I'd prefer the guys to just shut off the monitors and hear the mains. Well, I get to hear the mains. Like, you know what I mean? So, anyway.
We used to have good times together. But now I feel them slip away. It
Just keep playing, okay. I want to trip out on this thing a little bit, but I think we'll just shut up and sing.
Let's do radio silence.
Yes.
It's up against the wall. Static waves and lonely days, no messages or calls. Ooh. Your isolated heart, like living in the dark. Won't let go of pain that grows bigger than a spark. Frequency is strong.
Thanks, you guys.
Let's start a new thing where everybody mills around when you play songs. It's the new dance, man. It's like... It's true, though. We were working on this thing yesterday, just plug it in, and I was walking all around playing guitar, and it was incredible how it was all even no matter where I went. Yes.
Standpoint, because you're used to using
I like the fullness, and I like that I'm feeling in the environment, and that's the thing that I hate about, especially when she and I go out as a duo or a trio or anything that's, you know, the band is more complicated and it's a different thing, but even just in this simple format, I'm constantly feeling separate from the audience, most always because speakers are in front of me, just, you know, like was mentioned before, and that's, and I hate that. For acoustic guitar, you're already disabling it by making it an electric instrument and plugging it in. So you're losing all of these juicy extra frequencies that you get acoustically, you know? But with this, it just feels fuller and rounder, and it just feels like, I feel like I'm in the environment. And that's, I mean, for a musician, it's pretty inspiring. And, you know, when I trust that you're hearing what I'm hearing, then I can give you what I think I am. So there's so many times when Cindy and I, even as a duo, you know, we do tours where we open up for these acts, and they go like, well, we want you, but the duo is quick, easy, quick off, on and off, you know? So you may or may not get a sound check. And so you jump up there, and you're just trusting your muscle memory at that point sometimes, and hoping it sounds all good. You know? This makes me trust that I'm hearing, you're hearing what I'm hearing, you know, so that's cool.
Exactly. And you know what? You could send to the PA exactly what you're hearing. So if you need to reinforce it in a bigger situation, you can take your whole footprint and just, with a small mixer,
go anywhere you want, and if they need it bigger, you just hand them the stereo feed or the mono feed, and it goes to the PA.
So in other words,
goes 1,000 feet, no problem.
So we could use this in a restaurant or a cafe
at
the Greek.
System if you want.
Yeah.
Or at the Greek restaurant. I think they have time for one more if you want to.
Yeah, of course.
Hey, Aspen.
More love?
So what is going to the space station? Is it going to the mixer, then the space station?
No. There's a mixer feeding the space station. That's the two. By the way, the new, I don't know if people didn't notice this, but the inputs to this are completely protected by an angled input jack here. So they come around the side. This is the feed from the mixer right now.
Is
everything's
that
going to the mixer.
Is
that
patentable?
Got a stereo feed going to this.
Is
if
that
this
patentable?
Washer fill full, huh?
Is that patentable?
Not only is it patentable, we have applied for a patent. Believe it or not, nobody had ever done that before, although it seems very obvious. How many times have we broken our input jacks or our cables, one or the other, when the amp falls forward? So nobody had done that before, so that's one of our patents. The other one is the digital side speaker thing. So, and then, of course, the patent, the center point stereo, which is still patent.
Cool.
One more, and then we'll have some answers.
Let's do it.
Hopefully.
Aspen, thanks for having us and letting us be a part of this.
Singing on the
is their CD, that song, and the earlier one, that Radio Silence, this is on their new CD. This is an amazing CD. There's some great players. Elliot Easton's playing guitar. Greg Leash is the steel guitar player on there?
Leash.
And Phil Parr on piano.
And Dave Way recorded, mixed, and mastered this. Some major dudes. Anyway, it's a great CD. They'll have some if you want to take that music home with you. Where's Dean? Did Dean go away? He was all over me to make sure we were done at this time so we could take some questions and answers. Does anybody would like to talk about questions, answers, anything you've heard here?
Since you can move that one speaker anywhere, does that cut down on mic feedback?
Well, yeah, actually in this situation, we have a pretty small stage and it's a very dead room, but they're very close to it. I like it farther away. I if it was me and it was a bad room, I'd be sticking it over there in the corner and I'd be over here. And the farther you get away from it, the better it works. The more time those two speakers have to interact and reflect upon each other, the more they push each other away, the better the dispersion, the more three-dimensional magic that kind of happens with center point stereo. So it works kind of opposite any speaker. I tell people you've been using flashlights all your life, speakers that are very directional. The guitar player's got one, the keyboard player's got one, there's monitors, there's PAs, and there's all these beaming flashlights of sound everywhere in the room. So it really does have so much difference in where you sit in a room, what you hear. Because of the way this works, because of the way the two speakers interact and push off each other and create this three-dimensional sound, it's actually got two big advantages. That's the first, I think, the most important is the mix you're hearing is the same everywhere. And it's less of a feedback issue because it's not a flashlight, it's a light bulb. And you can hang it anywhere in the room and you're going to pretty much get the same light everywhere. And that's a whole new concept. The other thing about it is most guys who are musicians who want to play in stereo, whether you're a keyboard player or a guitar player, you're used to a strong center point where your amplifier is. And when you have two speakers, one over there and one over here, it's traditional stereo. You have a phantom center. It's unless you're standing in the perfect spot between two speakers, you really don't have a center. You've got too much left or too much right. And then if you get too far back in the room where you're not, if you're back from the sweet spot, and those two signals that come together, they are in-phase signals, and they're going to mix. And because they mix, they're different, they're going to give us anomalies. Certain things are going to cancel, certain things are going to get doubled. And they don't sound nearly as good as in that little spot that we call the sweet spot, where everything comes together 30 degrees on angle from two speakers. Of course, you've got headphones, that's great. Yes, question?
Yeah, so first, well, two questions. How do they actually mix for it? I'm thinking about...
As wide as you can. Okay. Well, we've been mixing mono for so many years. In fact, most PAs, which are stereo compatible, are rarely run in stereo because the mixer wants to know what he's hearing is what everybody in the room's hearing, so they generally don't use stereo live.
I sometimes mix at a club downtown in Hollywood, which mm-hmm. is a big international thing. And I hate that place. Mixing in mono.
Yeah.
I have great acts, and everything is in mono.
So in a big club down there, I would put one of these speakers in the front of the room like you have here. Brian, could you turn off the rear speaker just for a minute? And at the back of the room, I'd put one of these.
Now it's on.
Yeah, and that's what I want you to hear. Is that they don't conflict, but if I had a bigger room and I want distribution, they actually do very well. They play nice in the sandbox together. They don't. The effect doesn't go away. I'll throw a little reverb on my voice so you can hear a little more dimension. One, two, one, two. So it really does sound like a hall in here. Now, if we were to sum the mono right now, can you sum the mono on that thing? Is there a way to do that? What you would hear is a lot of that hall would go away because the stereo will go down. And so... you get to keep stereo, no matter where you're at.
Second point, can we try to hear something where you actually pan on the mix and see what's actually happening?
Well, yes and no. I don't have a delay on a guitar like a ping pong right now. I don't have anything pulled up that'll do that, do I? And can you pan on my voice? I don't think you'd hear it on my voice. You'd have to have something that was pretty hard right, hard left. But it's not going to have the hard right, hard left feel that you're used to because of the strong center point. That's another good point on Leslie. You know, Leslie, even though it has a spatial sound, is very strong in the center. You know, you know where you're standing on Leslie, but it's coming around to you, so it's no problem. But this actually creates the same spatial front-to-back stereo that you'd get from a Leslie. I think that's why it's so convincing. It really sounds like a Leslie. But a hard right, hard left pan, I don't think we've got anything that'll do that, do we? But it almost have to be, if I did hard left, hard right pan on a Leslie patch, which would be the Mysterios, you would probably wouldn't hear much difference.
Just your voice.
Huh?
Just try the mic.
Mike, do we have a ping pong on my voice? We don't, do we?
No, but I can. No, just the dry mic. Keyboards
left and right. Try that. Honestly, we're going to be listening to this for... Brian, he wants to play some keyboards. Is he off? Oh, okay. So now, is this me on some sort of a...
Echo.
Okay, so can you pan me left and right? So, but now he wants to see me go the other way, right? That's what you're asking?
Hear
one side. Because this would be one side, and now the other side, and this is the other side. There's a slight difference. Yeah, I'm listening to myself the first time here. But put it straight up again. It's better there. Equal parts. That's the problem with the world today. We're just nobody's in the center anymore. We had to mix it in the center. But we need... Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to do that. You know what I mean? Love is in the center, right, guys? Man, we need more love.
Right, when you said...
Do we have any questions for Michael while we're here? Can you take some of the talent off the microphone?
Michael.
I got it.
When you're playing out live, how close to the wall can you get the speaker? And where do you normally put it?
Oh, I've never tried putting it close to a wall.
Works better
close to
the
a wall?
The more reflections, the better. Yeah, the wall, the floor, the corner, optimum.
What do you recommend? How many feet from the wall? I mean, you got to get some reflection.
It's a light bulb. It's not a flashlight. Yeah. And you're asking a flashlight question. You follow me?
Well, I thought the speaker going out the side need to...
It will help. Space it all helps.
No, but I get where you're going. And I get a lot of questions like that because we're used to working with flashlights. Where's the best place to put it, right? How should I aim it? It's a light bulb, man. You just put it anywhere.
The bloom. Tell them about the bloom.
The bloom. Okay, so this is a kind of a thing. See, so if I'm right next, if you were to walk up next to this speaker and you were right in front of the front speaker and you move over and you're in front of the side speaker, you're going to hear weirdness because the front speaker is going to sound pretty dry and the wide speaker is going to, the side speaker is going to sound pretty wet. But if you get about 5 to 6 feet away from it, even the farther the better, then this interaction thing happens. If anybody's ever tried to put two magnets together and you notice there's one way they go right together and there's another way you can't get them to go together, that's out of phase. That's what we have. We have two speakers out of phase. It's an audio no-no. And in this case, it's a yes. Because that out of phase is...
7 feet or in is...
Exactly. Okay, you see where you're standing right now? I want you to get up. I want you to walk right up next to that speaker. Could we play something on there? Put that backing track, put the music back on real quick. So like that radio silence. Now, you're gonna hear what I'm saying. You hear what I'm saying. So now, see where it is right now? Now, turn that speaker, it's on our little rotor. Go the other way. Okay, now you're real close to the side speaker, see what I'm saying? Sounds like wetness, right? But if I stand over here, it starts to sound more balanced. And same for you. Now, if you were to walk around a little bit, see what I'm saying? I'll go walk over there. So, right now, come on over here and then pull right up in front of it right here. See what I'm saying? So the farther you get away from it. Now, this is a horrible room because the acoustics are perfect. We don't ever get to play in rooms like this. We get to play in crappy rooms. And the more reflections, the better. Okay. Any other questions? Comments? Yes.
How does it operate outdoors?
Interesting because of the lack of corners and walls. Yeah. It actually works better than I thought it would. I've got a band that uses it. I've had so many people write me letters, and people that are playing live, that stopped playing live, love this box because of this, all these friendly characteristics, but playing outdoors was a challenge. They do a winery up north where it's they play in a 360 and they're in the center of a gazebo, and they bought two of them. They point one to the rear, one to the front, and that was their solution. But it works really well outdoors, much better than you think it might. The ground is the best reflector. That's why I recommend don't elevate it. I'm just doing this so you can see it, but I would always use the ground as your friend, and a wood floor is your friend. Yes?
What's the solution for large venues, though?
Well, first of all, I don't think large venues are broken. I think small venues are broken. And I think this is the golden bullet or whatever, silver bullet or the whatever for small venue. Large venue, it's more of a challenge. And frankly, I haven't installed a lot of these in large venue, but I think it's a distribution issue. In other words, I would use multiple units spaced far enough apart, and it would be fantastic. I would put one dead center up and above. I would use the ceiling is just as good as reflecting as the floor. So in my studio, in my place, we've done a lot of live concerts, haven't we? Where we have a one upside down up here in the ceiling. And the reason upside down, because I want the side speaker to interact as quick as possible with that reflective surface. And then what we have is one, we did a one with that Constance Demi concert that was off the hook. She played, she had a couple of keyboards. What are those keyboards? Really, the really expensive ones, you know.
Three chord keyboards.
What they were the other one, no, the other one.
Really?
No, it's even more expensive than that.
Kurzweil,
thank you. She had two Kurzweil, she had a Roland, she had this space bass, she had a bunch of acoustic instruments, and we did a concert in our studio. She had one in the front, one in the back, a hammered dulcimer, and we had one in the ceiling. It was phenomenal. I mean, it was like you were, I would like to say it reminded me of my 60s, the years of the 60s. You had some of those years. But, you know, it was actually better because I didn't have a hangover. So, any other questions? Comments? Okay, are we going to give something away? How do we do that? Do people like, okay, so. Well, those are tanks. People have, did you get everybody get one of these little? Oh, all right. So we're giving away these dual top microphones, which, by the way, when I had groove tubes, a lot of people, maybe don't know, but I had a company called Groove Tubes for years. We won a tech award for this mic. We were nominated 5 times. The only time we ever won, we won for this dual, this simple idea of taking the top off the microphone and turning it into a drum mic or a guitar mic. 146 SPL. It's a tremendous overhead mic. It's a great acoustic guitar mic. We have a video online. You can see it being used with very little any effect, EQ or anything, on a guitar and a voice. So you can see it. And it's very hypercardioid. So here we are. We're going to try one now. So we're going to give away. What do I got to do?
No, Brian.
Brian, give him some of Michael's mic. You want to read it? Or should I read it?
All right, go ahead and read it. We're going to be giving away.
So probably the last three numbers is enough.
Yeah.
078. All right. So you get a choice. You probably want the mic and the pop filter, or a book. Signed book. So when we give away the mics first, I guess, right?
Yeah, let's give away the mics first. You can meet me back at the front counter, and we'll get you taken care of.
Okay. So you want to have them hold both of those?
Yeah. Right.
You hold both of those. Okay. Okay. So now we have 067.
Hey.
All right. All right.
Congratulations.
Okay. So we're going to move right along, and then. We have 074. 074. All right.
All right.
I never win anything. This is actually more fun giving it away, I have to say. And we really appreciate you all coming out. This will help fill the gas tank on the way back, right? 05050.
Wow.
All right. Now you get to play with one of my microphones. And so is that 5 mics now? No, it's
four mics.
Okay, one more mic. This is the last mic we're giving away. 080. Going once. 080. Okay, it's a wrong time to be in the bathroom, guys. Okay, and this is 063. Aha. Okay, so I guess I'm just going to leave these here with Dean and you can give me your number. So those are the microphones, and now my two-band book, 140,000 copies in circulation, and we will sign one to you. 068. Excellent. Yes. 070. Boy, we got a lot of O's going here. 070. Again, long time to be in the bathroom. Let's put it over there. And 071, if that's the guy standing next to him. Nobody? 071? Jeez, what's going on in the bathroom, guys? This is not the 70s, right? I mean, well, I don't know nothing. 058.
Yes.
Okay, we have a yes. You got a book, signed two-band book. Remember, because we're going to forget, because we are 70. 057. Next to them. 58 and 57. How'd that happen? I guess I'm not doing a good job. Is that where you go? This is the good ones? You're sure?
Yes.
I think those are the good ones.
Well, these are the other good ones.
They're the other good ones.
Mike, good ones.
There's two kinds of good ones. All right. So this would be 066. If you ever plan to travel west, yes. You got a 66? Dude, you're happening. How many have we given away of those?
All right. So we've given away.
Because we have six books.
Four of those, two more.
061. All right, two-band book. And everybody basically who's here tonight has the opportunity to buy a space station and get an extra 10 off or $139 microphone. And that lasts for like 30 days, right, Dean? Something like that.
Yeah, we can do that.
Okay. This is the last book.
This is the last book.
It doesn't
end. We can do that.
All right.
079. Excellent.
Okay.
Good. You know, I like that the people that got stuff were the people that asked questions. That's really cool. Okay. So now, what do we do? We thank everybody.
Yeah, thank you all so much. Give it up for Aspen Pittman, everyone. Give it up for Michael Bosch.
Wait. Jed Rock West and Michael Bosch, please. As we're going to mingle, we're going to talk, we will continue to take questions. Anything you want to know about this stuff, we can tell you. And then in the where we came in, the entrance, I believe there's going to be Bear Pit Barbecue, established in 1954 by Tennessee Ernie Ford, 16 Tons, Mr. 16 Tons. Had the first musical variety program on television, and the Bear Pit was the sponsor of that. And my family owned that at one time. My cousin still owns it. It's the best barbecue if you've never been there. Mission Hills. We're going to have slider sandwiches. It's pork, beef, and turkey. And we have vegetarian beans and vegetarian coleslaw and vegetarian condiments on the side. So we're getting coconut water. We have Stella beer. We have a wonderful red wine from Portugal. So help yourselves, guys, and enjoy it. And thank you so much for coming out, really.
Yeah, thank you.